so we can hear you up here.
This morning I lost my glasses. Okay, I can't. No, these are not my real glasses. Cheaters. There's a place near to me where I'm lost. Sundays were spent with our friends at the old country church. Precious years of memory. Oh, what joy. church and the Savior above and His wonderful love saved my soul in the old country church. How I wish that today all the people would pray as we pray in the old country church. If they'd only confess, Jesus surely would bless as He did in the old country church. Precious years of memory, oh what joy they bring to me. How I long once more to be with my friend at the old country church.
ring and set.
What a day, glorious day that will be. There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, when I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one. Day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, when I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day, glorious day.
Y'all may be seated.
Y'all sing along with this and help me. I need all the help I can get. It's the first time we did this, except for this morning. Why me, Lord? What have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known? Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do that was worth loving you for the kindness you've shown? My soul's in All I'm taking from you. All I'm taking from you. I'm lost. Maybe, Lord, I can show someone else what I've been through myself.
Lord Jesus, once again, it is an absolute blessing to be in your house this morning and to get a chance to visit again with my brothers and sisters in Christ. And we just thank you for the opportunity that you have given us to do that today. Lord, we ask your blessings on Chris this morning as he brings your message to us. Lord, through this message, may you teach us how you want us to pray to you. We thank you so much for Jesus who went to the cross and died for us. And we ask all of these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. Good morning. Well, I have to admit to something. I told y'all fib. I know I said last week that we were finishing up the Beatitude series, and I'm sorry, but I fibbed. It's not exactly the Beatitudes, but it's all part of Sermon on the Mount. And so if you want to be getting out your Bibles, Book of Matthew chapter 6, if you want to be finding that. But this week I got to ask a question. And I get asked this question quite often. And the question I get asked is how do you pray? What am I supposed to say? Or the comment usually is, I don't know how you do it. Said, I can't pray at home by myself. How could you get up there in front of all them people and do that? I'm afraid I'll mess it up. I've never understood why people think that praying is so difficult. I think the reason that people think it's difficult is because I don't believe we really understand what praying is. I think that we have this idea in our mind. I think we try to make a mountain out of a molehill. So what is prayer? Let's look at our scripture this morning. Matthew 6, verses 7 through 13. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Would you pray with me this morning? Lord, I pray that we are here this morning with open hearts and open minds. I pray, Lord, that every heart is open to the Holy Spirit, Lord. We have sung, we have worshiped with song, and now we're going to worship with scripture, Lord. Lord, I pray for a spirit of understanding. I pray for a spirit of grace. Most of all, Lord, I just pray that you bring this message out of me with the same power that you brought it to me. Lord, we love you, we thank you, and we just ask this in your name. Amen. What is prayer? I know there's a lot of people, there's a lot of different denominations of church that try to make prayer into some great big elaborate something. You got to have on certain kind of clothes and be in a certain kind of position and be in a certain place. Well, I'm here to bust that bubble this morning. Prayer is very simple. Prayer is just a conversation between you and God. And that's it. It's really simple. But there are some things that we do need to include in prayer. There are some elements, if you will, that will help you as you pray. Now here Jesus is talking to the disciples. And he's telling them these are a bunch of fishermen, they're a bunch of thugs, and they're uneducated, and they're, Lord, we don't know what to say. How do we pray? And he said, pray like this. Well, I get asked all the time, why don't we say the Lord's Prayer? We don't say the Lord's Prayer because it's prayer by rote. It's prayer by memorization. Jesus has no interest in prayer by memorization. And we're going to get to that in just a minute. We don't believe in saying things by rote. We don't believe in just memorizing and repeating. Because basically when you do that, you're just checking a box. You're going, okay, said the Lord's Prayer. I'm good. How much thought do we put into something when we memorize it and then repeat it? How many times have you ever been at home and been on your knees and just crying, praying so hard, saying, Our Father who art in heaven? It doesn't happen very often. But we're going to get into this today. There's elements that we need to have in our prayer. When you're talking to your daddy, there's some things that we need to have in this prayer. Point number one, we need to worship. Point number one is worship. When you pray to your daddy, you are worshiping him. Matthew 6:9, pray then like this, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Prayer begins with worship. You address God as our Father, or Jesus did, but it's worship. One of the biggest misconceptions in the church is worship is just singing. Once the band stops, worship's over. Now we just try to stay awake. No, everything that we do is worship. Prayer is made up of many things, but worship is the most important. In fact, you go back and you read Matthew chapter 6, from verse 1 to verse 18, he says the word Father 10 times. He is saying his Father's name in worship. Prayer is not something that we do to let God know everything that's going on around us. It's okay, God knows. Get to the point. Talk to your daddy. We worship by telling him our needs. Now this is where it gets sticky sometimes. We worship by telling him our needs. When you worship God by telling him your needs, you need to understand what you're doing. You are telling God, I can't do this. So I need you to help me. It is admitting that you, as a man or as a woman or as a child or teenager or whatever, I can't do this, God, without you. Daddy, help me. My wife and I, between marriage and dating and talking and all that kind of stuff, we've been around each other almost 23 years now. Don't clap for me, clap for her. But we were talking the other day, and my wife is your normal South Texas cowgirl now. She don't come out and she doesn't blurt out stuff and she doesn't get emotional and all that kind of stuff. But we were sitting and we were talking, and I said, you know what? I said, we've been together this long, and every day when I get home and I walk through the door or you come in behind me, whoever comes in, as soon as I hear your voice, my heart still skips a beat. People, when you talk to your daddy, his heart skips a beat. He loves you that much. Now, there's some of us, when we talk to him, his heart might stop. And I hope you're not one of those. But we need to worship him. We need to talk to him. We need to make sure that God understands that we know that without him, we couldn't even walk. Now, the next thing that we need to have in our prayer is reverence. We need to respect our daddy. I mean, how many people in here would disrespect your daddy, your father? And when I say daddy, people, don't anybody get your feathers ruffled. If you go back into the Greek and you translate the word, it doesn't say father. It says daddy. He's our daddy, or he wants to be your daddy. We have to have reverence. God's hallowed be your name. Do you have reverence for God in your heart? You have reverence for God in your life. How do you have reverence? This is an easy answer. You let God be who he is. You don't try to put God in a box. So you know what? God, when I need you, I'll call you. Or when something bad happens, man, I gotta have you. But the rest of the time, I got it. Biblical prayer is an act of faith, an expression of dependence. If you depend on your Father, then you will have reverence for him. You will worship him. But the whole question, the whole deal, the whole gist of today is, you can't depend on somebody else's prayer to get you through the day. You can't depend on somebody else's prayer to save your life. Jesus even said himself, meaningless repetition, it's worthless. In fact, he says, meaningless repetition is just to manipulate or badger God into compliance. Let's read what he said about it. Matthew 6, 7 through 8. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Is it not ironic? See the grin? This is fixing to be good. Y'all ready? Is it not ironic that the prayer that is said in more churches in this country, Jesus says right before he gave it to them, don't just keep saying the same thing over and over and over again. It's worthless. It's babble. Isn't that ironic? But see, we even got the whole thing wrong. This shouldn't be called the Lord's Prayer. This should be called the disciples' prayer. Jesus Christ never needed to ask for forgiveness, but he knew that we would. So he laid this pattern. This is how you pray. Once you learn how to pray, then you pray on your own. He wants you, for you to have a relationship with your daddy, you've got to talk to him. And you're not going to say the same thing every single day. Well, and how do you pray? This is another question I get asked. How do you pray, preacher? Got to get down on my knees? If I got to go and hide in the closet? Let me tell you how they prayed in the Bible. Several different ways. The first way is you could pray prostrate. I said it. I didn't do it first service. Prostrate. Daniel 8:17. So he came near where I stood, and when he came, I was frightened and fell on my face. So you can pray laying straight down on your face. And then he says you can pray kneeling. Acts 7, verse 60, and falling to his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And then he says you can sit down. 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 18, then King David went in and sat before the Lord and said, "Who am I?" So you can sit and do it. And you know what? You can also do it standing up. Mark 11, 25, and whenever you stand praying, whenever you stand praying, it's fine. This is not a mechanical act. You can pray driving to work. You go to San Antonio, I know you're praying every morning and every evening. That place is crazy. But you do have to ask yourself this question. Are you worshiping your Father in prayer? Are you praying more in public than you are in private? Are you praying more in front of people than you pray at home? Because if you are, you're more worried about a reputation for piety instead of being a son or a daughter. Well, now that we know that prayer is made up of worship, along with worship will come point number two. Now, everybody hold on. Your wish. Point number two is wish. Matthew 6:10, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Shut up. Get back to that wish part. I like that. Wish, wish, wish. When you pray, people, what do you pray for? What do you pray for? What do you ask for, or what do you tell God is your wish? There's lots of different things that you can ask for, but what we need to be wishing for, we need to be wishing for God's kingdom on earth. We need to be wishing, your kingdom come, your will be done. That would fix about 99.98% of this world's problems. So when you pray and you wish, don't just wish for the new truck or the new horse or new AR or whatever. Wish for God's will to be done. Wish for it to be on earth as it is in heaven. Nehemiah chapter 1 verse 5, and I said, O Lord God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments. God fulfills his promises. He promises if you ask, he will give it. Speaking of asking, I don't know if you can see it over here, but we got an instrument on this stage that needs to be filled. If you know anything about playing a piano, you need to come talk to us. We even got a sign up. It says, we're hiring. Keyboard player wanted. Pay ain't that great, but the benefits are out of this world. So while you're wishing, wish for us a piano player. Nehemiah, we're gonna get to know Nehemiah real well this fall. We're gonna dig into that. But Nehemiah is saying, this is a request. If you ask, God keeps his word. Wish for the millennial kingdom. Your will be done. Your will be accomplished today. Not tomorrow. Not when you decide to come back. Your will be done now. This old ball of wax needs some help, Lord. It needs it today. Wish for his will to be done the same way that Jesus prayed for it. Matthew 26:42. And for the second time, he went away and prayed, my Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done. How many times when you prayed do you say, God, your will be done? Your will, not mine, Lord. It's a tough one. We all got things we want to wish for. That's not probably very high on a lot of people's wish list, but that's where it needs to be. 2 Samuel chapter 10, verse 12, be of good courage and let us be courageous for our people and for the cities of our God, and may the Lord do what seems good to him. Wish for his will be done. Wish your kingdom come. And after you've worshiped with prayer and then you've wished for that kingdom, then that only leaves one place to go. It's point number three. Then you get to ask for what you want. Point number three. want? All right. That's what I've been waiting for. What do I want? People, I'm fixing to... Want and wish is two completely different things. Neither one has anything to do with the other. So what is it this morning do you truly want? Not a wish, but what do you want? Matthew 6, 11 through 12. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our debts, as we have also forgiven our debtors. When you say, I want something, this is something that you have to have. We all want food. We all want water. We all love Taco Bell, or not Taco Bell, Whataburger, excuse me. Thought I was back in Tennessee there for just a second. We want these things, but what we really need to be wanting is God. Because we have shown we can live without food for a while. But can you live without God? I hope you can't. Because if you can live without God, then we're in trouble. God has to be your biggest want. He wants to provide sustenance that the only place you can get it is from Him. There's no one that will love you the way God does. There's no one who will take care of you the way God does. Sometimes we might not understand how He does it, but that's where your will be done comes in. This model of prayer that Jesus gave, it contains six requests, six wants, if you will. The first three are all about the coming of the millennial kingdom. Here he talks about daily. What is it you have to have daily? Well, you got to have breakfast. You got to have lunch. Got to have supper. Got to have a couple snacks in between. Hope don't go by Dairy Queen because your dog needs an ice cream cone. I mean, these are things you have to have. You have to have water. You've got to have shelter. Lord have mercy, you need air conditioning pretty bad right now in South Texas. These are things you have to have. Daily means sufficient for today. So don't be afraid to ask for your wants. What do you need today? Don't be afraid for what you need to ask for what you need to get through today. You see, it's very possible that by you showing God that you're dependent on Him for your wants, that you are completely dependent on Him, that you want God, that you need Him, that you have to have Him, then you will have the relationship that God had with the Israelites in the desert. The Israelites cut donuts in the sand for 40 years. Nobody ever dehydrated. Nobody ever starved to death. God provided. That's what we have to do as well. He wants that relationship with you. He wants you to look at Him and say, God, your will, not mine. I know you will provide. If you want it, don't be afraid to ask for it today. Worry about today, because tomorrow has its own set of problems. The second three are all appeals in the light of the coming kingdom. The millennium kingdom, it's coming. It's request for spiritual needs. The first big one is forgiveness. I want to be able to forgive people who trespass against me, people who lie to me, people that steal from me. I want to forgive them. I have to forgive them. Or do I? Let's just see. Jesus' example says more than forgiving. When Jesus said, forgive those, or excuse me, I'm saying it the old way. Well, I just went blank. Luke 11:4, forgive us of our sins, for ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us. People, this is one of the most misunderstood scriptures in the Bible. When people tell you if you don't forgive others that God will not forgive you, that is incorrect. That is not correct. Jesus says, and he explains his forgiveness policy. Matthew 6, 14 through 15. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive yours. That sounds pretty plain, don't it? People, your forgiveness has nothing to do with anything that you do. Now think about that. You were forgiven. You were washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. That is how you were forgiven. Now, if you don't forgive others and that keeps you out of heaven, then that means that you have to do something to be saved. And the scripture is very plain. You don't. We can't. We're like ants to an elephant. We can't do it. Your forgiveness as a Christian, when you forgive someone, it's not because you're scared you're not going to go to heaven. You are forgiven because you know in your heart that you were blessed because Jesus has already forgiven you. Now, that's the blessing. That's why you forgive. Not because you're worried you don't get to go to heaven. You forgive because you are forgiven. Ephesians 4, be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. That doesn't say God forgives you because you forgive so-and-so. God in Christ, his blood, forgave you. You should want to forgive others because you are forgiven. This forgiveness thing, your walk with God has nothing to do with forgiveness. Forgiveness doesn't save you from sin. The blood of Christ is what saves you from sin. Believers understand that if you don't share that forgiveness that you have been given, you don't share it out of fear. You forgive because you have been forgiven. Believers also recognize their spiritual weaknesses with temptation. James tells us, chapter 1, verse 13, let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. Hang on, here we go. But each person is tempted when he or she is lured and enticed by his own desire. How many times have you sat at home and go, man, God, I wish you'd take this stuff off TV so I don't have to watch it? You don't. Turn it off. Lord, I wish you'd take all this sin away and then I wouldn't have to do it. Then get away from it. God didn't put it there. You have to say, I want to be delivered from evil. I want to be delivered. I need to be delivered because I can't do this on my own. Please protect me from myself. You know, one of the most important things about the Lord's Prayer, Jesus never intended for you to memorize the Lord's Prayer. He never intended for 2000 and whatever the year is, I'm drawing a blank, 2023, he never intended for us to be saying it. Use it as a pattern. It's a pattern for the servants of the kingdom. He told this to his disciples, pray as I am teaching, pray as I am praying, but it is not a magical formula. You can't just say the Lord's Prayer and you're good. I grew up in the Methodist church. I mean, if I had a dime for every time I've ever said the Lord's Prayer, every time I've ever said the Apostles' Creed, the Nicene Creed, all that stuff, you know what? Every time I said that in church, my mind wasn't on it. That's just what we're supposed to do. Got to say it. Check the box. We're good. It's not what Jesus wanted. It's not what he meant. He wants you to understand the words he used, ladies and gentlemen, his words, there's no saving in those words. His words were no different than the words you would use. Pray as I am teaching you to pray. Pray like Jesus prayed, not the words that he prayed with. The words aren't what saves you. The words aren't what get you to your daddy to talk. Say to him what you need to say, not what somebody else needs to say. This is the point he's trying to make when he said, this is how you should pray. This is a pattern. That's all it is. It's a pattern. When you don't know how to pray, say it. But there's going to come a day that you step away from it. How many of you guys and ladies been married? You get married, you don't know what to say, so you say the same thing over and over with. But eventually she's going to look at you and say, is that all you got to say? And you're going to go, yeah. That's the way it is with God. God doesn't want to hear what Jesus said. He wants to hear what you have got to say. He wants to hear what your want, what your wishes are. He wants to hear your worship. So when you talk to him, make sure in worship. Let him know you love him. Let him know you know you can't do anything without him. Don't be afraid to ask him to wish. Lord, your kingdom come. Let your will be done. Fix this planet that we live on. And then don't be afraid to ask for your wants. What is it you've got to have to live? One day at a time. Once you follow this, watch and see how your heart gets softer. Watch and see how the forgiveness will flow out of you. Watch and see how your life will improve. All because Jesus said, here's how to pray. Pray with me this morning. Lord God, we come to you. Lord, we are so blessed that you left us this pattern, that you left us this outline. Lord, we pray that as we go through the day today and as we lead through these doors and we go to work tomorrow or on vacation or wherever it may be that we're going, Lord, that we literally pray the way Jesus prayed. Not his words, but the way he prayed. Your will be done, Lord, not mine. This is what I want, Lord. I want you in my life, Lord. What is my wish? I wish that you were here with us, Lord. These are the things your daddy wants to hear. Don't be that one that when you say and you pray to him that his heart stops because he doesn't know who you are. Be the one that his heart skips a beat because, oh, there's the one I love them so much and they love me. If you're here this morning, you've never gave your heart to Jesus. If you're here this morning and you've never dedicated your life, you've never stood and said, Lord, I am sorry. I repent of my sins, and Lord, I want to follow you. I want you to be my daddy. Help me to learn how to pray. It's not about words. It's about heart. It's not about words. It's about faith. It's not about words. It's about love. Do you love him? And if you do, do you pray? Lord, we love you, we thank you, and we just ask this in your name. Amen.
If y'all please stand and join us.
Number one would always be me, and I thought I could be what I wanted to be, and I thought I could build all life sinking sand. I'll make Jesus my all and all. And when I'm in trouble, on His name I'll call. And if I don't trust in Him, I'll be less than.
Time. Dear Lord, we are just so grateful for you. We love you so very, very much. Lord, I just ask you to put your hands over this congregation, Lord. Bless us all. Lord, we all have our challenges. We all have our needs. We have members who are ill. We have attenders who've not with us anymore, that this week is going to be a challenge for all of us. Lord, I just ask you to please bless us. Be with us, Lord. And as we go out these doors, let us go up to people and say, let me teach you how to pray. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Lord, we love you. We thank you. And together, all Wilson County will say, amen.